People in rather odd circumstances are what most of my poems are about. Mixed up with arguments, religious difficulties, ghosts, death, fairy stories, and a general feeling of guilt for not writing more.
Many of the poems of Stevie Smith are illustrated by her own drawings, mostly of cats and saints, young girls in extravagant hats, witches and unpleasant children. Stevie Smith was born in Hull and came to London at the age of 3, a fact, she says, quite without significance. But at the time it seemed like moving from city to country, for Silas Green, where she has always lived, used to be wild open parkland in Middlesex, now a London suburb. By her own definition, her life has been almost comically static. For some years during the war and after it, she worked in a London publishing house. But this has been her only job, and most of her life has been spent writing poetry, novels, and criticism. She belongs to no school, no movement, no cult of poetic writing. She has a basic dislike of all poetry and never reads it if she can possibly help it. In her own poems, behind the facade of laughter lies fear and a sense of being abandoned. She likes to sing some of her poems. Several of them go to hymn tunes and traditional ballads. Others go to old music hall songs of the Victorian age, like this one called The Warden.
Why did you take me away from the children I love so well? I had other thoughts in my heart, dear, for the child of my latest spell.
Stevie Smith has vast quantities of verse by heart and an exceptional memory, largely developed by the discipline of a classical education. When quite a young girl, asked to perform the messenger's part in a school production of the Bacchae by Euripides, she learnt by heart 136 lines of Greek phonetically.
Petty Pratuda, Daisy the Vile, you know, and it goes on line after line. I could do the rest of it now. I went to see it at Oxford, you know, in Volonarkis' translation. Only then, I mean, about 100 years later, did I realize what it was about. I knew roughly that it was a description of tearing poor Pentheus to pieces, and the mother coming on, you see, Agave coming on, thinking it's the head of a young lamb and stroking it. Show the head of her son, and Tiresias says, you know, I don't think you know what you have in your arms. It's not a young lamb at all, it's the head of your son, which you've torn off. Oh, it's a terrible play to give school children, isn't it?
It's the supreme terrifying play of all. It's more terrifying than any of Shakespeare's.
Oh, it's much more terrifying because the carelessness of the garden. And then when this wretched Dionysus comes on at the end and says, well, it'll cure you of this terrible sin of impiety towards the gods, won't it, anyway? And the queen, Agave, says, but is there no mercy? Must we now be sent into exile? Is there no hell? Then she looks at him, she says, I see there is no hell. And he said, why then postpone the necessity? Why then postpone the inevitable? Turns on his heel and leaves everything in ruin.
I suppose there is no hell, Prem.
Well, of course, you shouldn't worship. I mean, you must have gods, as we create our own gods. You might at least create sort of reasonably agreeable ones. I mean, if you will create gods of such atrocity, really, as these Greek gods. It's a cruelty. And the sort of superficiality, I mean, they're so touchy, you see. Oh, it is extraordinary religion. I don't know whether they believed it.
A feeling of guilt for not writing enough is often found in Stevie Smith's poems, and a preoccupation with the many irritations that distract a poet from writing. Not unlike the incident of Coleridge and the person from Porlock, is this curious encounter in the Confessions of an Opium Eater when Thomas de Quincey was living in Wordsworth's cottage in the Lake District.
And one day, this extraordinary thing happened. A Malay came to the door. In the Lake District, the last thing you would expect, you see. And the Malay said to him, have you by chance any opium? de Quincey gave him a piece of opium as long as a walking stick, and the Malay just broke it up and ate it all. And the critic expected him to drop dead, you see, on the door. Said, not at all. Didn't make the slightest difference to him. Off he went. He was going to Liverpool. Off he went. Happy as a lark. Dosa would have killed an army, practically, but he was so immune to it, addicted to it, you see, at that time. but the Malay could take any quantity. Well, De Quincey practically got to the same state. I imagine he would see crocodiles crawling out from long-buried sarcophagi, you see, and the mummies coming to life, and I was buried in the sand and bred with the crocodile's eggs. You know, it's terrifying dreams. Rather the sort of thing you get in art in Piranesi, you know, these fantastic interiors of prison architecture and the spirals, staircases going up into the depths of the sky, really. In my poems, the dead often speak and the ghosts come back. Here is a poor man who got drowned. His friends thought he was waving to them from the sea, but really he was drowning. Nobody heard him, the dead man, but still he lay moaning. I was much further out than you thought, and not waving, but drowning. Poor chap, he always loved larking, and now he's dead. It must have been too cold for him. His heart gave way, they said. Oh, no, 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 it was too cold always. Still the dead one lay moaning. I was much too far out all my life, and not waving, but drowning. This is another poem about being left in the sea and nobody taking any notice. I am becalmed in a deep sea and give signals, but they are not answered. And yet I see ships in the distance and give signals, but they do not answer. Am I a pariah ship? Or a leper, to be shunned reasonably? Or did I commit a crime long ago and have forgotten, but they remember? The general feeling about love in the poems is nervous, like this poor little child who has been turned to stone in his mother's lap. She clutches him and cries, I'll have your heart, if not by gift, my knife shall carve it out. I'll have your heart, your life. Life bears hard upon the children in the poems. But sometimes the little children are odious. There is a drawing I made of such a little child. It has written underneath it, 18 months old and already odious. There is a poem about an elderly man thinking back to the harsh girl he loved once on a sofa. It is called Pad Pad. I always remember your beautiful flowers and the beautiful kimono you wore when you sat on the couch with that tigerish crouch and told me you loved me no more. What I cannot remember is how I felt when you were unkind. All I know is, if you were unkind now, I should not mind. Ah, me, the capacity to feel angry, exaggerated, and sad. The years have taken from me. Softly I go now. Pad, pad.